In the picturesque Wiltshire countryside, a big operation is underway to transport one of the railway museum's hidden gems, the Glasgow tram. We'll move it from its old home to its new one. We'll delve into its rich history and follow the team of experts undertaking this complex maneuver. But moving this 16-ton Titan won't be easy.
Then maybe it's that error.
It's not open.
We'll find a solution. It'll be okay.
Every stage of the way.
The Science and Innovation Park. Formerly an RAF base, this 500-acre site consists of several runways, a herd of sheep, one of the UK's largest solar farms, and 10 huge aircraft hangars. They're home to trains, planes, and automobiles, plus thousands of fascinating scientific objects in the Science Museum Group collection.
We hold 350,000 objects from science, medicine, technology, a huge range from one of the last Fleet Street printing presses to Daleks to a wonderful collection of transport. So a huge range of material is held here.
In 2021, a new high-tech facility was built here, known as Building One.
So Building One is the new collection store at the National Collection Centre. It will hold the small and medium-sized objects of the Science Museum Group collection, as well as having freestanding grid and pallet racking for some of our larger objects held here.
Lucy Hadley is the project manager looking after many of the larger objects moving into Building One.
So today we are moving the Glasgow tram, the first of our large objects, into Building One from our hangar D3. So it's the start of a long programme throughout the summer of getting our largest objects here at NCC into their new building.
To move the tram, the team will first carefully lift it up onto a series of machine skates. From here, they'll use a forklift truck to tow it out of the hangar and winch it up onto the trailer of a lorry. Next, the tram will steadily make its way across site, heading around the service road, down the runway, and all the way up to Building One. Finally, it'll pass through three airlock doors and skate the remaining 200 metres home to its final stop on the grid.
So the operation today involves our contractors, Alali, so they've brought their team, and we also have my team involved, which is the internal moves team, and then also here with us are our logistics team on site, so they can see how this is moving for future moves.
Whilst the team are used to transporting objects around the site, moving the tram presents several unique challenges.
The Glasgow tram is approximately 16 tonnes, so it's 5.5 metres tall on its rail and platform, so it's a very tall object, one of the tallest ones that we'll actually be moving into the building. Due to the age and the size of the object, just the fact that it's quite top heavy as well, it means that we have to be rather cautious with how we move it, constantly watching to see where the pinch points are. So particularly when we're moving it across site, considering the weather conditions, and also take into consideration the age of the hangars and moving it out of the hangar doors. I've been planning this for the last 5 years. There's been an awful lot of work and thought. Really excited for it. It's going to be amazing to see it from its where it has been for so long, and then seeing it in a new place will be absolutely brilliant to see.
But before they can get to work, first they need to measure the wind speed to check it's safe to open the hangar doors.
Yeah, that's all right. About 5.5.
Having got the all clear, Collections Supervisor Callum starts the process of hand-cranking the World War II-era doors. The first hangar door opens without a hitch. But as he tries the second door, there's a problem.
It's not opening. We're not entirely sure what the problem is, but it's supposed to just turn round nicely, and the door slides down the track, and it is it's not in favour of it this time.
I didn't have a lot of Weetabix this morning, so that may be the issue.
Yes.
The tram is currently positioned just behind the malfunctioning hangar door. If they can't find a way to fix it, the move may have to be called off before it's even begun.
There may have been a slight error, but we just need to figure that out as to whether or not this one will actually open. If not, we'll find a solution. It'll be okay.
Whoever skates with the weight.
Whilst the team figure out a solution, curator Will Sims has been looking into the tram's fascinating history.
So the tram was built in 1901 and it was built for the Glasgow Corporation Tramways, and it comes at a really interesting time. Glasgow first had trams in about 1870. Initially they would have been horse-drawn. By the time that this one comes into service, most of Glasgow's tramways had been electrified. So it comes at that really interesting time when we're going over from one form of transport to another. The Glasgow tram service was incredibly popular, and this would have been because it was such a cheap service for passengers to use. So passengers would have been able to travel from one side of the city for just a tuppence, and you would have had all classes on it because it was a system for everybody.
With the outbreak of the First World War, many women took up jobs in the tram service as drivers and conductors. In 1918, when the war ended, Glasgow was the only city in Britain to keep women on in these roles.
This is a really important moment in social history, but it also helped to foster the real sense of community that the Glasgow tram service has, and one of the reasons that it was so beloved. In 1962, when it went out of service, 250,000 people gathered on the streets of Glasgow to see it go past for that final time, many of which took along pennies and they put them down on the rail so that when the tram came past, it buckled them, and then they could pick up the penny and they had a buckled penny as a souvenir of the last time the Glasgow tram went past. So we have some amazing photos here in the archive at the NCC of the tram actually moving into the Science Museum in 1962. And there's some amazing shots of track being laid down for it to move into the museum itself, and kind of all of the elbow grease that goes into moving such a massive object. So it's quite interesting to see all the different men in brown coats walking around trying to work out what exactly needs to be done to get it in, but also how close some of the clearance is on some of the doors. As it is now, it's still quite the logistical feat.
Meanwhile, back at the hangar, the door is still stuck fast, but the team have come up with a plan. If they move an object blocking the way, there should be just enough room to get the tram through the gap and out the open hangar door on the opposite side.
Because the door isn't opening fully now, we have actually had to move one of our objects within the hangar, which is the Royal Bank of Scotland airship unit, in order to gain the manoeuvrability space. Then using machine skates, they're going to bring it through the hangar and then swing it out through the hangar door and then straight onto its trailer.
But even with the object removed, it's going to be incredibly tight. The tram will have to squeeze past the tail of a Trident III aircraft and the closed hangar door with just inches to spare.
Yeah, we're confident. We're confident that we're going to get it through there. We'll all be watching just to make sure that it is a safe manoeuvre before we really take it beyond and out into the outside.
Because the tram is so top-heavy, they have to be extremely careful, slowly jacking up each corner one at a time to ensure it doesn't tip over. The skates are then inserted, and the tram is gently lowered onto them. Each skate has a load capacity of 4 tons, and with 4 of them, it should be just enough to hold the weight of the 16-ton tram. Finally, they add a steering skate at the front, which will allow a forklift to be attached.
So the tram has now been lifted up and it's had the skates put underneath. So we're bringing the forklift in now, and the forklift will be attached to the front skate, and then the tram will be pulled out of the hangar onto the trailer.
As it turns the corner, its aging wooden frame begins to creak. Under Lucy's watchful eye, The tram just clears the frame of the door and narrowly passes the aircraft. All that's left now is just one sharp turn and the tram is free of the hangar. For the first time in 60 years, it basks in the summer sunshine, revealing its striking yellow livery.
It's better in the sun,
it's yeah. Stunning, isn't it?
It's expecting to light the light. We've got the tram moved to the doorway now, and now we're going to build a rail ramp. So that will take us from the pallet that the tram currently sits on onto our rail train. So the main thing that we need to do is to make sure that we get the rails and the tram and everything aligned, we get the levels correct so that we don't have it rolling one way or running away, and then we'll get the winch set up and be ready to load onto our vehicle.
With the winch now attached, the lorry steadily pulls the tram forward to meet the rail bridge the team have built. Then they start the painstaking process of aligning the rails. Wooden blocks are inserted underneath to ensure the connection between the rails is seamless. Any error could lead to a derailment, so it's vital they get it right. With both rails now aligned, the lorry resumes winching the tram onto the rail bridge and then up onto the trailer.
A couple of moments which was touch and go, but we were all watching, and then just to see it finally reach its location on the trailer has made me a much happier person. Much relief.
With the tram now safely secured to the trailer, it can begin the next part of its journey, around the service road and all the way down runway 22.
So the next steps are we're positioning the pallet with the original rail into building one first into the loading bay, and then we will pull the trailer into our loading bay, unhitch, bring the tractor out, and then using the winch we'll winch the tram back off of the trailer onto its original rail and platform, and then from there we will, using the skates, skate it into its location on the grid where it will live.
Made up of 270 colour-coded squares, the grid is an important feature of the new building. It might look like a giant game of battleships, but this intricate system is essential for the organisation and access of the collection. But to get there, the tram will first need to make it through the roller shutter doors.
It's going to be relatively tight, so the loading bay door is 6 metres high. The tram on its platform and rail is 5.5 metres high, and then we also have to take into consideration the height of the trailer as well. So it's going to be a lot of people watching, a lot of people making sure that there's nothing going to go wrong in that respect.
Martin has worked with the collection and on the object moves for several years. Today, he's on lookout duty.
Where essentially this whole building's airlock controlled, so we've got different doors controlling it, so essentially we've got to make sure nothing can go through that door into the rest of the building. Being middle of the countryside, could be anything, hares, birds, hopefully not something that big, but it could be anything, rabbits running, so it's my job to make sure no animals get into the building.
Has it happened before?
Not to my knowledge, but there's always a first time. Hopefully this is not the first time.
With no pests in sight, they use the lorry to gently winch the tram back onto the platform. It fits through the roller shutter doors with just enough room to spare. With the tram now inside, they can close the first airlock door and open the inner one. A forklift is attached, which pulls the tram into the main hall. Having made it through all three airlock doors, all that's left is the home straight, down to its final stop on the grid. After 12 long hours, a lot of elbow grease, and a slightly uncooperative hangar door, the operation is complete.
So the move went really successfully today. It was very smooth in the end, and although there were a couple of hiccups, the team were great. We found brilliant ways to get around it. I think it's a beautiful piece. It's an absolutely stunning piece. And then when we saw it move out into the sunshine and just saw the gilding on it just glinting away and the marquetry as well on it, it was just absolutely stunning. It's something that we've been planning for the last 5 years, and to see it here now is just an amazing moment, and it's one that I will always remember. So it's looking quite lonely at the moment, the tram, but this is just the first object of many that are going to be moving in over the coming months. So this grid is soon going to fill up with so many objects, it's going to look absolutely amazing.
In 2024, the public will be able to book guided tours of the new facility. Visitors will be able to explore our vast collection and marvel at this glorious Glaswegian giant.